Blackstone Publishing presents Murder Stage Left, a Nero Wolfe Mystery by Robert Goldsborough. This book is read by L.J. Ganser. To Otto Penzler, publisher and editor extraordinaire, for his continuing support and encouragement. Chapter 1. The reviewers at the Times, News, Post, and Gazette all had called it the non-musical hit of the season, or words to that effect, and as I sat that August night in the sold-out Belgrave Theater on West 44th Street during the first act of Death at Crest Haven, I wondered what I was missing that those esteemed scribes from the daily papers had seen. The drama, set sometime before World War II in the faded parlor of a Connecticut mansion whose best days were behind it, chronicled a family in decline, both financially and psychologically. At the center of the performance was Marjorie Mills, the tall and elegant grande dame of the household, portrayed as a woman in denial by longtime Broadway fixture Ashley Williston. Lily Rowan, seated on my left, seemed more involved in the action on the stage than I, and at an intermission in the lobby, I asked her why.
"I thought that you, of all people, would enjoy a good mystery, Escamillo," she said, using the nickname she had tagged me with years ago, after I had a run-in with an angry bull in an upstate pasture. "The acting is really quite good. Even Ashley Williston, who I know casually and who I've always thought tended to ham it up, both on stage and off."
"Well, I will withhold judgment until the final curtain falls, but for the moment, mark me down as underwhelmed. By the way, how is it that you happen to know the famous Miss Williston?"
"No, maybe overstating the relationship, but I have met Ashley on more than one occasion," Lily said as we shared a candy bar. "She entertained us with some monologues from her performances at a benefit banquet for an orphanage where I serve on the board, which was very generous of her. And we were seated side by side at a luncheon at the Plaza a year or so ago for a Send a City Kid to Summer Camp program. But I have to say that a little bit of Ashley goes a long way."
"How so?"
"The woman is always performing. Even in casual one-on-one conversations, she sounds like she is directing her pear-shaped tones to a theater-goer in the back row of the balcony. I almost felt like I should applaud after one of her pronouncements. And of course, everyone around us at the luncheon was constantly turning our way when she spoke. Not because the woman had something interesting to say, she didn't, but because you could hear her throughout the room. And it was a large room."
"Not how I would choose to spend a meal," I said.
"Nor I. But in a way, I do feel a certain sympathy for the woman. It is an open secret in the theater community that it galls her she has never won a Tony Award over her long career."
"Based on what you have said about her work, it seems like there is a reason for that."
Lily nodded. "Ashley has been one of the featured players in God knows how many Broadway dramatic productions, about four or five of which I've seen, and her notices have been lukewarm at best. The best way to summarize the reviewer's rap against her is that she tries too hard."
"How have the critics treated her in this play?"
"Kindly, overall. If I were to predict, I would say she really feels she's finally got a fair chance at that elusive Tony."
"My opinion of the play, and of Ashley Williston, improved somewhat during the second and third acts, although, as the drama of a fractured and down-at-the-heels family, set in a time-worn Connecticut country estate, the production was only fair. But the audience seemed to eat it up, particularly the surprise ending, and the cast got a long and largely standing ovation."
"Well, Archie, what is your verdict now?"
Lily asked as we devoured a late supper at Rusterman's restaurant, for my money, the best eatery in Manhattan, outside of the brownstone where I live. "It was not the best night I've ever spent in a Broadway theater, but it was far from the worst, and Miss Williston did seem to hold up her end of the proceedings relatively well, after all," I said. "Besides, no one has ever asked me to be a theater critic, so I am hardly qualified to judge the production. I figured those were to be my last words and last thoughts concerning Death at Crest Haven."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.